collaboration to a growing base, but, you know, about 10 years ago, we started MIT Collaborative Mission. They weren't that. I mean, I feel as if we need to come up with new words, something to further explain or replace collaboration, collaboration, innovation, innovation. So if anybody has any ideas, I'm open to those completely. And when I talk about unique collaborations, I mean just about anything. Now, it was a unique collaboration for civilian medical people to work with the military medical people. And I thought it was good to put them together because I could see that in talking about a system, the military health did have a system. And we, in a way, didn't. I felt we could learn from them. And of course, sometimes they can say, okay, everybody has a vaccination. There are simple things like that. But there are differences. And then what happened when they got together and started sharing information, they really each group thought a lot of the others. So we're still connecting them. And I've been actually facilitating some of the review and analysis meetings for the military health leadership and the Surgeon Generals of the Army, Navy, and Air Force, and have learned a lot. And when I say unique collaboration, I think of karate and Children's Hospital. I have a daughter who's become karate crazy because of her children. And it turns out there's a rabbi in Michigan, Rabbi Goldberg, and he was actually one of the CNN heroes not long ago. But he has a program where he's recruiting black belts, and particularly at Esposito, which is in Newton, and having them work with children who were in hospital with cancer, with really debilitating diseases, and some who are chronically in the hospital, with the idea of letting them feel powerful. He points out, I wish he could say it the way he does, but he points out that when they go into the hospital, there they are on the bed, you know, everything quiets down at night, but anybody just walk in the room, they don't, you know, okay, time to draw your blood, and, oh, we need to do this, and they don't have any say in anything. So he's actually has a program where he teaches them to push away the pain, bring in the light, and push away the pain. And then he tells them, you know, now you've done that, you're doing it well, that makes you a teacher. So he has them working, helping their parents and other people. And I never would have thought of putting karate with cancer patients, but it makes so much sense the way he says it. And seems to be working. And it's always a challenge to, if you have some unique connection, people aren't used to it, and it's hard to get that accepted at first. So any of these things can be considered unique and worthwhile doing. Now, Bob Langer is the ultimate collaborator. And he was the person who you graded. You know Bob? Yeah. Anybody not know Bob? But at the first meeting, the meetings I do, I like to have very interactive. I don't have people come to give lectures because I know if they're keynote speakers, and all of them could be, that they'll come 5 minutes ahead and then leave. But what I want is for those experts to interact with each other. So that's why we make it a very, very, very interactive meetings. So I asked Bob, the very first one we did at the business school, at Harvard Business School, if he would, at the end of the day, sort of pull it together. So he did. And then, you know, we thought that was a meeting and that was it. But then the people who came, and there were 90 people who that I personally invited, and I kept sort of a list of all their names. I put a dot each time somebody spoke. I remember the chief of medicine, Daniel Ciello, when I explained it to him, he said, oh, well, that sounds interesting, Telly. You want me to come and sit all day? I said, yes, and speak up whenever you want. And so I had 8 dots by his name. So, But, so the group said, well, let's take this further. Let's develop this more and concentrate on some topics. So we got the dean of the medical school to have one 6 weeks later. And then the group said, well, why not develop projects or something from this? So we had one with Benke Narayama Murthy at the School of Engineering at Harvard. And I asked Bob again, would you summarize the day for everyone? And so some time passed after that, and then Bob said, why don't you bring what you're doing at the medical school over to MIT? And I said, MIT is, it's a much more collaborative attitude. But I think it is quite remarkable, and it's, and I think, you know, even as we read the newspaper, you can read the collaborations that have developed at MIT that have come up with something that is clinically useful, whether it's in medicine or not. It's quite fascinating. It's really, really, really interesting. So that's how we happen to be there. And he's sort of our champion. I love it that if I have a question, I don't have to worry. He just, you know, answers so quickly. His reputation is that. But tell me about some other things that some of you are doing. Are any of you collaborating with anyone at another institution? Are you?
Me? Yeah. You're asking me, yes. Yeah. So I'm working with Professor Altarowitz at Harvard Med School, looking at electronic health records as well.
Good for you. That is that's been so hard for the military because the VA has one system and the military health system has another. You doing anything with Zach?
Yeah, so he's the head of the department. That's all terms. It's one of the faculty as well. Mm-hmm. But I'm not working with him directly in any way. Yeah.
Well, that's good. That's a big problem. And I just read that United Healthcare is going to reimburse physicians for telephone time or what they call the other time, telemedicine time or something that people have never done. Because it occurs to me, you know, if a doctor can get emails all night long from patients who need to know something immediately, that creates quite a difficult time, doesn't it? Especially if they're having babies. Oh. Tell us about it.
I'm not sure if I can.
Actually, HIPAA is something that's come up in the projects we're doing on clinical trials. That's a big issue there, too. And it's an issue for the researchers who aren't in medicine or anything to try to understand it. Issue for us to understand it, too. It was just Monday evening at a board dinner. I'm not on that board anymore, but West Pharmaceutical in Philadelphia. And one of the people there had gotten a call a couple of years ago that his wife was in the car talking to somebody on her cell phone, and the person said he heard a tremendous crash, but he couldn't find out. He knew what highway she was on, and he tried to call all the hospitals he could around that area, but no hospital was allowed to tell him whether his wife was there or not. He finally found one where he somehow figured out his wife was there, but they wouldn't tell him that she was dead or alive. So I think, you know, this whole HIPAA thing is very complex. But I've always thought, oh, I wish that groups I'm affiliated with would affiliate with each other. And you're very quiet over there. What are you doing? Before you take over here.
Before I do. So my lab is in for the computer science department and the biological engineering department. So my professor developed some ways in which you can essentially build computers that you can put in DNA and detect what the cell is doing. So you can essentially send biomarkers, and because you have this biocomputer, you can also actuate. So some of the things that we're applying them for example, detecting whether a cell has biomarkers for cancer and then burning the cell to die. Also doing that for tissue engineering, drug toxicity assays, and so on. So that's what I work on. Mm-hmm. So we're collaborating also with Harvard Med School as well.
Good. It was interesting, was a meeting where I asked Phil Curry to speak about MIT, and he did, he said, I just want you all to know that MIT has more research with MGH than Harvard Medical School does. I thought that was interesting. But I'd love to hear from some more of you about what you're doing. And what's known, I'm known for is you don't speak up, I call on you.
Never make eye contact.
I'm an Alan. I work as a strategy consultant in the solar industry. So for I'm also a research affiliate at MIT. So for me, collaboration is what I do with my research group at MIT, where I got my PhD as well about 8 years back. I work with current grad students, and then I serve as a sounding board to them. Mm-hmm. Where I'm now on the dark side, I'm in the industry, and I understand how the real world works. At least that's what they claim. That way. Mm-hmm. But the bright-eyed ideas come up, and then with a few questions, you can understand where the impact is in terms of how quickly or how viable some ideas in the market. So I enjoy the collaboration I have with current students. And
that's good.
Keeps me technically at least fresh.
Yes, that's true. Well, very good. And can you give us a little word on where you think solar is going?
I can talk all day. it's fascinating. Solar is not just a technology. I know MIT just released a report yesterday on the future of solar industry.
Oh, it did. What was that in?
Pardon?
What was that in? Where is the report?
It's on the MIT homepage.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I looked at that this morning, but I should have looked harder.
I, as a consultant, I'm in the business of forecasting where the industry will be 5 years out from today. And solar is not just a technology, it's more a future of distributed energy generation. It has vastly different implications for how the world will meet its energy goals sometime in the future. So that's, I'm pretty excited. As my colleagues tell, we like to live in the future because it's far more fascinating. You can always be wrong, you can keep guessing about where the world is going to be. And, so it's a very different world than just trying to get an experiment to work, but it has its own challenges. It's more humbling because everything you focus on.
I think things we should hear from every single person. My gosh, these are interesting. It reminds me of Maria Zuber said, well, when I mentioned something about it's nice to be in the midst of students here, and she said, oh, well, what's really great is you can walk in the infinite corridor, just tap anybody on the shoulder, you know that interesting things going on. So, that's really, really true.
So the last thing I'll tell about solar is Hunger Games. Maybe you've seen the movie.
Yeah.
So it's
a movie or the movie?
The first one. If you know the story, that's fine. I like to call solar as the Hunger Games for local electricity. Oh. Is it solar as distributed generation or decentralized generation, which is the utility? And only one company or one provider, you just need one provider for electricity. You don't, if you can get everything from solar, you don't need your utility.
Hopefully with a better outcome, though.
Someone has to die.
Well, we were told medical school is just one to a customer. Who else would tell them what you're doing? How about you?
Me?
Yeah.
Sure. My name is Krista. I am a first-year MBA student at Sloan right now. And I'm not doing anything that's nearly as exciting as the rest of you. I came from the world of finance. I was working in investment management prior to business school, and I'm still figuring out what I want to do after business school.
Hmm. And how do you decide?
That's a good question. This summer I'll be working in healthcare consulting, so I hope to have a window into that one.
You have a lot to solve in that one. Anybody else willing to speak up?
Sure.
I'm Kat, and I'm a microbiology graduate student. And I work in the chemical engineering department, and I engineer bacteria to make useful chemicals, including flavors, fragrances, and biofuels. So the idea is this bacteria will use sugars, a renewable resource, and make a useful chemical. So finding, making chemicals in a petroleum free way.
Mm-hmm. That's a huge project.
Yep. It's fun though.
Yeah, good. Yeah, I think maybe we're drawn toward challenges around here, don't you think?
Yeah, definitely.
Thank you for doing that.
And maybe since we only have about 10 minutes left, we could ask if students have some more questions for
you.
Yeah,
that would be great.
Anyone has, I think, anything about what Dr. Anything,
Lewis talked
about?
Anything.
Or
go ahead.
Someone have a question?
Yes. So how do you recognize when a collaboration is going to be successful? I mean, I don't know if successful is the right word, but whether it's going to be a useful way to spend everybody's time, or when it might not work, or does that matter when we put a collaboration together?
Well, that's an interesting question. I think to begin with, maybe before you start a collaboration, you have, well, Bob Langer would say collaborations are serendipity. And of course, collaborations can be carefully planned as well. But I say the serendipity, just go for it and grab it. But you may not know if it's going to be work or not. I didn't know if the systems approach was going to work. And we were very quiet, you know, the first couple of years, particularly, well, we still are, but because we felt we had to have something under our belt. How can we say systems approach is a thing that we should look at this with if we didn't have any record of it at all? And I imagine they don't all work. And now, can anybody think of one that really doesn't work? Trying to think of different groups that I'm involved with. I guess you could say that the future Olympics around Boston may or may not work. We don't know. And in a way, that's a collaboration because you're putting people together who don't know anything about each other's sports or don't know each other. And yet, the minute you walk in those gates of the Olympic Village, you feel as if you're family practically. You're all there for the same reason if you don't speak the same language or you're from another part of the world or have totally different sport. Oh, here, right over there. And what's your name?
Hi, my name's Carrie. So I came to this talk because I saw Olympic figure skating somewhere in the title. I walked in late, so forgive me if you've already gone over this. But I was curious, I guess coming from a figure skating background.
There are a few here.
Oh, okay.
All figure skaters put a hand up?
Yay.
That's great.
So I was curious, you know, given that the Olympic figure skating is very much, I guess, a, more of a solo competitive sport, what have you taken from those lessons in what you do today, given that now, you know, what you're doing is much more collaborative?
Well, I didn't think if anybody asked me when I was skating, I wouldn't think there was any connection. Somebody said, oh, you just change from one blade to the other. But looking back, I can see one obvious one is time planning. Another thing has to do with what I call surgical conscience. And that's when you're in the OR, there are many times when you have to figure out, you know, is there something else I can do? Is there a way I can do this better? And it may be that, well, if I do it that way, that I feel it would be better, it would take 3 more hours. And so you make that decision, and it's surgical conscience to take that out of yourself, to do everything you can, not considering anything like, oh, it's almost dark out or something. But, and that's, in a sense, it's probably the wrong word to use, but you need to be creative to figure out what is absolutely best for the patient. And In figure skating, I always wanted to create new things, new moves, new jumps. And nobody knew if I was trying hard and falling. But I knew I was trying my best. And also, it's embarrassing to say, but there is the same kind of feeling of exhilaration when you know you've done your best, whether it's with the ice rink or in the OR. And only you know. So there's that aspect. And I think, I wouldn't apply it to surgery, but I mean, and being willing to take risks and do something even if it wouldn't be considered the usual. And so I think having the courage to take risks, well, one lesson is you fall down flat, you get up. And you certainly learn that from skating. And Bob Langer would be the first one to tell you, I mean, he tells about, he got a rejection to every single resume he sent out to anybody for the longest time. And I'm sure you've heard him say that nothing is ever a failure, because if what some people would call a research experiment failed, he said, no, you just figured out one more way, it didn't work. So I think some of it is attitude and being willing to push on and being interested, being curious. And I think that would be a message that I would like to say. I think that innovations do happen through collaboration, and I feel it's important to be open-minded and be aware of things that are happening in other fields, things that don't seem to apply to you, but seeing if there's a way that you can, you might say learn a lesson or incorporate the thinking in a way you might not have occurred to you before.
We have time for two more questions.
That's a dare.
Any of the figure skaters have some questions?
One of them is actually that has choreography lessons with my daughter, Elin.
I took a lesson.
Hi. You too?
Yeah, it's a pleasant time.
Oh, good. Now, I've got Jenny's name. I'm going to have you write her name too. And I'll have to let everybody know. I'll have to let you know when she's doing a Christmas show at Kendall School.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Perhaps I can ask a question. What is the thing that you miss most about your past in figure skating? It seems that your life has changed so much since then.
You know, it's funny you say that, because I do dream about it. And it feels so good just to stay up in the air as long as you want.
Yeah, I think I'll
make a couple more rotations and land over there. But then I also fly a lot of my dreams. Who flies in their dreams? Do you all fly? Yeah. What does that mean? Where's the psychiatrist here? I'm always so surprised when I can't do it when I get up. Just, you know, and then just levitate. Feels so good. I guess the next question is, do you dream in color? I don't know what that means either. Well, it's just wonderful to get a chance to be with all of you, and I'm very disappointed that I don't know what every single one of you is doing, because I'm sure I have a lot to learn in there. How many of you work together here? Who do you work with?
Two.
Yeah. Thank goodness.
Dr. Albright, perhaps you could give us some closing remarks as we wrap up of, as students in this position, what role do you think students can play in some of the collaborative initiatives that you're involved in or you're thinking about moving forward? As a lot of us are thinking about graduation in the next few years in positions, how can we position ourselves to be most useful or be involved in some of the projects that you're engaged with or thinking about for the future?
Well, that's something very interesting, because I do feel very strongly that it's important. When we get a bunch of, what should we say, experienced experts together, sometimes we realize, you know, they're calling for change, but those of you who are here, the rising leaders, you're the ones who are creating the change, and we're depending on you. And I think it's very important to have interaction between between the, you might say, generations. We don't call them young leaders because that makes the others old leaders. But, and I do think it's important to engage. And sometimes we get a chance to put together groups of both to interact. And I'd love to hear your ideas for that. Because you have a lot to teach all of us. And I say that sincerely. I mean, it'd be nice to be able to know everything. But all I know, and I guess what's so fascinating about the fields we're in, is we're always learning. And that's the exciting part of it. So I'd love to keep in touch with you somehow. And thank you so much for sharing.
Great. Thank you so much, Sean. So with that, Glenn, if you want to, we have a thank you gift for our speaker. It was great having you here with us tonight. From the SB community and the MIT student community and outside, we're so glad that you could spend this time with us today. We appreciate it, and I think we heard some new ideas today that we can take with us moving forward. So thank you again for coming to this lecture.
Yeah, sure.
Well,
thank you.
That's so much of you. Oh, that's beautiful. I love it. Oh, how nice. Sydney Pacific Presidential Fellows Lecture Series, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. I treasure that. Thank you so much, every one of you. So really appreciate that. Who made it? Is this one of the
I wish I made that. Maybe I'll
put it on the
This probably a pollen.
So maybe I'll hand over to Gwen to close us for this evening.
So thank you all for coming. It's a great pleasure to see all of you here. So regarding those people who have the name tags are invited to join us for dinner. And with that?
Yes, so we'll just meet in the back.
Yeah, we'll just meet at the back of the room for those with name tags and who receive an email from us regarding the dinner with the speaker. So, and lastly, we'd like to thank, of course, Dr. Albright for coming all the way here to speak to all the students, and thank you, Neil, for introducing the speaker.
And we can say this is our final and our fifth and final COSI lecture of the year. We were really excited and enjoyed being co-chairs this year, so thank you to all of you that have come to other lectures in the past. And we're transitioning over to Sebastian and Jay-Z. They'll be leading COSI for next year. So if you have new ideas or people that you'd love to hear from, please reach out to them. And thank you for the Associate Postmasters, Julie Neal. They've given us great support this year. So we appreciate it. So thanks to all of you, and thank you again to all of you.
In talking about a system, the military health did have a system. And we, in a way, didn't. I felt we could learn from them. And of course, sometimes they can say, okay, everybody has a vaccination. There are simple things like that. But there are differences. And then what happened when they got together and started sharing information, they really each group thought a lot of the others. So we're still connecting them. And I've been actually facilitating some of the review and analysis meetings for the military health unit collaboration to a great base. But you know, about 10 years ago, we started MIT Collaborative Initiative. They weren't that. I mean, I feel as if we need to come up with new words, something to further explain or replace collaboration, innovation. So if anybody has any ideas, I'm open to those completely. And when I talk about unique collaborations, I mean just about anything. Now, it was a unique collaboration for civilian medical people to work with the military medical people. And I thought it was good to put them together because I could see that. So he's actually has a program where he teaches them to push away the pain, bring in the light, and push away the pain. And then he tells them, you know, now you've done that, you're doing it well, that makes you a teacher. So he has them working, helping their parents and other people. And I never would have thought of putting karate with cancer patients, but it makes so much sense the way he says it and seems to be working. And it's always a challenge to, if you have some unique connection, it's at Esposito, which is in Newton, and having them work with children who were in hospital with cancer, with really debilitating diseases, and some who are chronically in the hospital, with the idea of letting them feel powerful. He points out, I wish I could say it the way he does, but he points out that when they go into the hospital, there they are on the bed, you know, everything quiets down at night, but no, anybody can just walk in the room. They don't, you know, okay, time to draw your blood, and, oh, we need to do this. And they don't have any say in anything. Yep, and the Surgeon Generals of the Army, Navy, and Air Force, and have learned a lot. And when I say unique collaboration, I think of karate and Children's Hospital. I have a daughter who's become karate crazy because of her children. And it turns out there's a rabbi in Michigan, Rabbi Goldberg, and he was actually one of the CNN heroes not long ago. But he has a program where he's recruiting black belts